Remember that when we tested the drive circuit, almost everything works, but we had a slight problem where the motor would accelerate even when the pedal was not pressed. We would prefer a car that can, you know, stop. So we set out to fix this by programming our controller so it better understood what our pedal was trying to tell it.
Going to do a couple of things while we've got the soldering stuff out, replacing the loop with an actual rocker switch. But the other thing we're going to do is hook up our UART stuff to the controller. UART. That's how you pronounce it.
So we're a little bit confused because on the diagram it looks like there should be a little block attached to this and there's not. And these traces don't seem to go anywhere, at least beyond this other block of four here. Then there's these other communication pins too. So we think we're going to go with this set of pins here per the diagram because...
Well, this is for the isolated block that we don't have. Okay. I think they just go directly to here though. Trying to make these two permanent because probably going to want to remove them.
There we go.
I've been trying to move everything closer, and we definitely unplugged your monitor because I saw it go black.
The USB port's the wrong way.
Of course it is.
There we go.
This computer here, we can just use SSH to log into it from a command line, and then we can control it from any other computer on the network. I don't want to sit down here in front of this table and this whole giant mess. I mean, there's like ammunition, battery, computer, zip drive.
We should probably not have ammunition next to a battery.
Wait, you don't
want to... Well, I think this is... No, this is...
No, there's live ammo in there.
Lovingly press the controller while we program it.
And juggle some ammunition in our other hand.
To communicate with our controller, we need to use UART. For each communication to send data to it, you have to have an address byte, which tells you which device you're communicating with. A write command, this will be any kind of command that you're going to write to the controller. And then there's two data bytes as well to pass data onto it. The CRC byte is used to check for data transmission errors. And reading data is a bit different, but I'm more interested in writing right now. You calculate out a value of four hex digits here for some of the values that you send. When you're calculating those values out, there's this whole guide about how to get that four-digit hex value and turn it into something that the controller is going to understand. We're trying to send 05C5 to the speed register. 05C5 is not the same as 0B and 45. This is what you send to the controller to get this value into there. I wrote this little script that takes an input to four-digit value, turns it into base 16, that is a hex value. It just takes the first part of it effectively. It's a little bit more complicated than that. Then it also... Yeah, it does some stuff, okay? And then it runs it through this formula to create the CRC value. If I do the 05C5, enter, the ones that are useful to us is the 0x, and that would be a 0b, but it doesn't have the leading 0 on it, and 0x45. And you can see that's exactly what they tell us to do here. So now we know it works.
So this looks like an error of some kind. But it's actually Tom's desktop.
Whoa, 813? I'm imagining, like, some people will have a custom keyboard, you know? I'm imagining you have a custom keyboard you hook up to this, and it just has one giant key and just a screenshot. And that's all you push.
No, it's one of those dipping birds.
This is why I have this folder here called Next, which is where the files go.
So open up a terminal.
Yeah.
I'm just imagining someone plugging a power strip into itself now. This is the solution you came to. Now we're going to do sudo rm.
No.
Okay. I almost did. I got through three letters before I realized.
It's
going to
be sudo apt-get install space python 3.
Now they've gone upstairs to do the programming, and my job is to sit down here and keep an eye on the blinking lights.
I got the library installed, ran into this problem.
Ooh, whoa, whoa, whoa.
Which I didn't get when I was writing the script on my computer, but apparently it wants me to configure the serial port in the program before I open the connection. Normally, you just do serial.serial, and that gives you an object that you can use as a serial interface, and you don't have to configure it until later. That's what I did when I was testing, but that error tells me that I need to put the baud rate port and timeout in this constructor here. Most common thing with Linux is you have permissions there.
We've written something to the controller, theoretically, and we got one. So that's the first time we've got a response yet. After some discussion, we're going to try these two ports here. They also show up in the documentation as TX and RX ports. I've got my TX and my RX into these ports now. We'll see if that does anything different. Okay, I've got to start up again. Now I've got three pins going into the speed ground hole.
Okay, let's see if anything happened. Nothing happened. This is the last test. If this doesn't work, then we're just gonna have to ask the manufacturer. That always returns a 1. And just like every other time, that does nothing. We've had another reverse the polarity moment. We switched the TX and the RX cables. I don't even know why I'm saying we because I'm doing this, but I'm getting a lot of help through Discord here with Jason and Mike. Switch the TX and RX cables, and now I can write, and then I can read. Oh, well, it didn't work this time. Here you can see where it actually worked, but now it didn't work.
Here's where we quote-unquote reverse the polarity, but we're still making only incremental progress, so I'm gonna reset this dip here. Number 4, to change the mode of communication and see if that helps. I'll turn it off first. Okay, turn it back on. And we'll go upstairs and keep testing.
Let's just try to read to see what happens. Oh, read gave me something. Okay, what if I try it again? And then it gives me nothing. Whatever we write to it, we only get 1 read every time we start the controller. The read is always 0. I assume what this means is that we're feeding it stuff that it can't read.
Tom will edit this all to make it take probably minutes, but this is week 3 of us fucking with trying to communicate with this controller. Last week we actually had some kind of communication, and this week the device isn't even being recognized by the computer. This somehow became hot. We think we might have destroyed it on accident. Fortunately, we have another USB as serial. I'll use Tom's phrase of big brain geniuses, because we're just trying to make something to prop this cable on top of so that the pins stay in it. And so far, it's not going very well. All right. We're afraid that the pins are not actually making contact, so Jason is just wrapping it in electrical tape. We finally got another response. The response is still 0, which is not ideal, but at least it's something.
Well, there were 156 bytes in the buffer. There's a bunch of different stuff, which is kind of encouraging, but also very confusing. Like, ampersand isn't exactly a hex value. Neither is the greater than sign.
We're back in 1 step forward, 2 steps back mode. We didn't change anything, in effect, and now it's not working the way it was working before. Jason's undoing the electrical tape. If we at least isolate the problem to being that the contact's not being made, we can make it contact better. Now we've got 56 bytes waiting for us, which is strange, so we'll go ahead and read that. Look at that, we got a bunch of shit. Let's try writing that. Okay. Let's see if we got anything. Nothing.
Disconnect. Reconnect.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
So that's just junk then.
I guess
most likely. So we just got 15 bytes by disconnecting and reconnecting the cable. Again, see what we get this time. 9 this time. Wow. Now we finally got back to where we were 7 days ago. It just gives us back whatever we write to it.
We're trying to research this controller to see if we can find any resources on how to use it. And I can get it in either Czech or Slovak. But I mean, if I just knew what a VROBG is, then maybe I'd have some idea. This is the dog. The dog's name is Klidat. Now we're trying to use a different piece of software called RealTerm, and we just got some junk.
Disconnect them and just...
Oh, I'm getting all kinds of stuff now.
Disconnect the transmit to the receive.
Nothing.
Nothing?
We're continuing to fail. The best success we've had so far is just getting the controller to send us back exactly what we've sent to it. We'll just let Tom do a voiceover and explain that we failed today.
Our great advisor from afar has recommended that we disassemble this pedal and just check the potentiometer inside. Then we can see if the potentiometer can be recalibrated such that it actually goes down below the voltage threshold of the controller. And the reason we want to do that is because right now, without even pressing the pedal at all, the motor begins spinning and accelerating. We don't want that. We want the motor to only begin accelerating once you press on the pedal.
Well, this is what happens when you buy the cheapest pedal available. I already stripped this screw. I'll try the other screws and try to get it out, but this makes me very inclined to just buy a better pedal.
I'm not sure this is really a potentiometer. So we have this thing here. It looks like a transistor, and this, suppose that's a magnet. They run up against each other.
The conclusion is we think that this is actually a Hall effect throttle, not a potentiometer pedal, so we'll test it as such.
The Hall effect, it has a plunger and it has like magnetic coils, and the plunger goes into the magnetic coils.
Plunger? It doesn't matter. What about an Oates effect?
See what happens. Yep.
Oh, so that's it. Oh, did you see that? It actually blinks when you push it.
Huh. Oh.
So that's letting us know there's current going through it.
Wow, it's actually acting the way it's supposed to.
Vroom, vroom! Yeah, it slows down when you undepress it, which last time it wasn't doing.
Yep.
The first current foot test.
Down, see. So.
Oh,
post feet.
Uh-oh.
You probably just
pulled it. Uh-oh. He broke something.
Oh, no.
It works for a while, and then it stops, which is probably not great.
Yep, there, just put it against you.
Yeah,
the light what's did up? This really funky thing. Check the batteries, too.
I think it's the battery, personally.
So, we weren't able to program the controller, but we also don't have to. Shout out to the YouTube commenter a few videos back who predicted that this was a Hall Effect pedal, and I'm sorry we didn't test that right away. The spirit of our channel is to show our trial and error process, so enjoy all the errors. It would still be nice if we could program the controller someday, because then we can change the curves to help with driver comfort while accelerating. But for now, we're done rolling that boulder uphill. In the meantime, at this point in the project, the controllers seem to want to shut off after about 10 seconds of spinning, which is also not ideal. My suspicion was that this was because one of our batteries was right at the edge of a voltage where it can discharge. The batteries only have the charge they shipped with. In the next video, I'll show you what happened when we added the SEPEX field to the circuit, and a video where we unbox and attach our charger should be coming soon as well. So keep tuning in to find out if my guess about the source of the random shutoffs is correct.